Hello and welcome to another episode of the Combat Fit Podcast. I'm of course your host Raffy, and I am here with the two official brothers of the Panel Biter, Christian.
Hello.
And Bennett.
Hello.
Today we're talking about Batman Black Mirror. There's a lot of back work we have to do for this, but it's written by Scott Snyder, the Snyder I like.
You calm down, all right?
With art by Francesco Francavella. And also art by Jacques.
Jacques?
He goes by Jacques.
Okay.
Is he a French painter?
Yeah. The story is about Batman, but not the one you're thinking of.
Okay.
He has his parents.
As if, no. It wouldn't be Batman if he had his parents.
Impossible.
So, this is going to be fun, right? Because you guys are familiar with Robins in certain degrees.
Yeah.
Like, the last time I had been on the show, we talked about Damian Wayne Robin. The first time I had Christian on the show, we talked about Jason Todd Robin, you know, the one bang, dead, that one.
Yep.
but in this book, it stars the first Robin, Dick Grayson, who is Batman in this book.
Okay.
Yeah, so Dick Grayson was Robin when he was like 10. When he was like 18, he moved up to being Nightwing. That was mainly just because he wanted to get out of Batman's shadow. And also, some of the writers were complaining about, like, well, we want to use Batman and Robin, but they just keep using Robin in the Teen Titans books, so what are we supposed to do about it? I don't know, you could just say that when he's not with them, he's with Batman. No, we need a completely other character. So they meant to Jason Todd, and then Dick Grayson becomes Nightwing. During this time period, this is the part where it's like, I gotta say something like weird comic book shit fast, and you're familiar with that style of doing this. So during an event called Final Crisis, Batman was like, hey, Darkseid, fuck you. And Darkseid was like, oh, no, you don't. And then shot him with laser beams, not with a gun. Kind of character. I am the new god, Darkseid. Bam! He shot him with it's called the Omega Sanction. And it's just this thing where it's like,
who names this shit?
Darkseid does.
Okay.
Yeah. And Darkseid's like, I'm gonna shoot my lasers, but not the one that kills you. And Batman's like, okay. What is it? It's almost like more scary if he's like, the beam won't kill you. And you're like, but then what does it do? Because I assume death is the worst thing, but now you're saying it's something else. They're like, it's gonna send you through time. You're going to experience all your past lives.
Wouldn't it just be easier to kill him?
No, because this way he'll die like hundreds of times throughout every lifetime.
But the way he beats it, though, right?
That's... And to the rest of the world, it's like he's dead. Because, like, he gets shot, and then he's gone.
Okay.
And everyone in the world is like, he's dead.
So what, then does Darkseid just live off the fact of knowing that he's...
Just knowing... I don't think he lives for long. I think in that event, Darkseid dies at the end. I think Superman is the one that kills him.
So you know what? If I'm fucking going out, fuck you, dude.
Yeah, well, that's the best part, because since he dies, it's like no one else knows that that's what happened to Bruce.
Yeah.
So there's like a separate book called like the Death and Life of Batman or something, and it's about Bruce's journey through all of his lives to get back to the modern day.
Oh, shit.
But to the rest of the DC Universe, Batman's dead.
Yeah, that's cool.
Yeah, and around that same time, a writer named Grant Morrison is like, I want to do a story where we're like, it's more experimental with Batman. Batman's out there doing new things.
Is Grant Scottish?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Just make sure I got the accent.
Yeah. So Bruce Wayne has this press conference. This is before he's dead, obviously. Since nothing bad will happen to me, I'd like to have this press conference. Bruce Wayne comes out and he's like, I have a secret to reveal about Batman. And of course, everyone, the readers, the people in the book are like, is he going to, like, admit that he's Batman? Is this going to be, like, an Iron Man moment? And he's like, I have been funding Batman. And everyone's like, oh, for Christ's sake. And so Bruce Wayne provides money to this thing called Batman Incorporated, which is, like, there's Batman in every part of the world.
Okay.
That's how we get Squire. And he also provides money to the Gotham City Police. Now, when Batman, Bruce Wayne, dies, because Darkseid shoots him, you know, dies in quotations, the Wayne, like, foundation goes to, like, his next of kin, which is Dick Grayson.
Okay.
So, he becomes Batman, he's Batman in Gotham. At the time of this book, I think Bruce Wayne is back from his time travel bullshit. I don't know if the public knows he's alive. All I know is, like, Dick Grayson is still being Batman because Bruce asked him to. The book starts out with this kid who's on, like, a swim team at his high school. And he's getting bullied because, I guess, even in high society swim teams, there are still bullies.
Well, of course, yeah.
We swim better than you, yeah. And this kid gets really mad. He goes into his locker and he reveals that he has this vial of some sort of, like, chemical.
Oh, yeah.
And it's, like, it's heavily implied that he uses it as, like, a strength hormone,
okay.
Right? Like a performance drug.
Yeah.
Okay.
But we don't know what it is. And so he gets angry and he takes the whole thing. And then, like,
Bane?
And then the bully kid is swimming in the pool, right? Another successful day of bullying kid. And then, from the water, it looks like a small killer croc, like, comes out.
Jesus Christ.
And just, like, eats the kid. And then the killer croc, the mini croc, he's like, I've eaten the bully, and then he dies.
Jesus.
So both these kids are dead, and the croc kid is obviously...
Another dark side fuck you woman.
So obviously the croc kid is the one that got bullied. So the cops are doing some investigating. Commissioner Jim Gordon, who's still, you know, at it, is, contacting Batman.
That motherfucker's been around.
For a long time, yeah.
He's seen some shit.
Only reason... Batman does some investigating. And what's fun about Dick Grayson being Batman is that he's kind of scary in his own way. Because actual Bruce Wayne Batman is just, like, scary. Like, that's part of his whole motif. But with Dick Grayson, it's like, Batman smiles and makes jokes at your expense.
Really?
Yeah. Okay. And it's like, to see, like, an intimidating figure like that, and then he's like, man, you're really bad at crime, aren't you? Man, you really do
sure
nothing.
Man, I'm trying my hardest.
Yeah, exactly. I'm doing my best, man. So... He does some detective work and looks at it. It turns out this kid, his parents are the ones that, like, purchased those vials of, like, Killer Croc formula.
Of course.
And they get it from this, like, black market group called, like, the Mirror House. In the process of learning this, the guy that he... Because he has to talk to, like, a corrupt cop to get this information. And this corrupt cop is killed by a thing that's in his tooth. And you think it's, like, a cyanide pill. It's, like, a little poison ivy seed that grows, like, roots out of his head.
Oh, shit.
Okay.
So, more investigating, Dick Grayson investigates the formula, because he needs to find out, like, beforehand if it is Killer Croc formula, and to do that, he uses, like, the Wayne Lab over at, like, the GCPD, and it's funny, because it's Jim Gordon and it's Dick Grayson, and again, we don't know if Jim knows that Dick is Batman, whatever, but, like, this is also Dick Grayson, like, a kid who's been around in Jim's life since Dick Grayson was a child. Because Jim Gordon, of course, is the father of Barbara Gordon, Batgirl.
Oh, okay.
So, Barbara and Dick grew up together. Dick knows Gordon, right? They're in the lab, and Jim's like, Dick, I gotta say, like, I'm glad you came down here to help me with this lab stuff. And I gotta tell you, like, this lab isn't really used. He's like, what do you mean? Like, we built it for you guys. We put it here. It's been here for, like, months. He's like, yeah, no, none of the cops down at the precinct want to use your lab. It's too hard to understand. A lot of them are old-fashioned.
Jesus Christ.
And Dick Grayson's like, so you called me down here because you don't even know how to use this stuff. He's like, yeah, basically. Eventually, Dick Grayson finds out about the Mirror House. And the whole time he's being orchestrated, or at least, like, helped out by Alfred, who's in charge of the penthouse, because Grayson doesn't want to live in the manor. And he's being helped out by Barbara Gordon. Now, at this point in time, Barbara Gordon isn't Batgirl anymore. Because back in, like, the 80s, the Joker shot her in the spine, and she was paralyzed, and now she goes by Oracle. She's essentially superhero tech support. Now, the thing about Black Mirror is that it's essentially three stories that, like, aren't big or complicated enough to kind of be their own things.
Yeah.
So, the first story deals with this, like, secondhand, like, black market of people who are buying and trading supervillain, like, technology and weapons. Like, that's why that family had, like, Killer Croc formula. It's why, like, the way the dude died was, like, a poison ivy-related thing. And it's interesting because... So this is, like, 2010, I think. In 2011, DC reboots with New 52. A lot of writers change books and stuff, but Scott Snyder continues to write for Batman. And in his first Batman run of the New 52 reboot... He invents a group called the Court of Owls, which is, like, an organization of, like, rich people who hide their faces with masks and, like, do rich people crime.
That sounds familiar.
Yeah, they're, like, you know, let's kidnap a bunch of homeless people and put them in a maze and see what happens. We're bored and rich, you know? And it's interesting because in this book, which, again, is before that, when they introduce the Mirror House, it's a bunch of rich people in masks who get together and have these, like, secret meetings that involve, like, criminal stuff.
Oh, shit.
So it's not that. It's not Court of Owls, but it's, like, clearly Scott had the idea in his head of, like, no, the next villains for Batman shouldn't be, like, people with mental illness or poor people who are just criminals. The real criminals that Batman should be fighting are, like, rich people.
That's pretty cool. I like that.
Yeah. So, Dick Grayson, he has to go through several steps to get into this, like, auction, basically, which is being run by a character called the Dealer, which is just an old man in, like, crutches walking around. It's just like, you line him up with the rest of the Batman villains. He's like, and then there's me. So, he has to go through several hoops. Essentially, like, he has to get... I don't know why this technology was so popular at the time, but he has to get a face mask that changes how his face looks. And I say that that's popular because around the same time, in the second Captain America movie, Black Widow puts on one of those masks at the end, which changes her face.
Okay.
So...
Then they use that in the Black Widow movie as well.
Yeah, and that's like a different universe and stuff, but it's like, for some reason people had that idea at the same time. But like, it's cool because Dick Grayson's in his own lab, and he's delivered the ID mask by Tim Drake. Tim Drake was the Robin after Jason.
Okay.
At this point, Tim is Red Robin, yum, because Damian's shown up, and he's like, I'm Robin now, and Tim's like, okay, you're Robin now. They have a moment in this book, it's almost unrelated, but like, they're like crime dudes doing crime things at the docks, and it's nighttime, and they're like Russian dudes with tattoos and sunglasses, and it's nighttime.
Yeah.
And Batman and Red Robin are watching. And Red Robin's like, okay, we're going in on this, and Batman's like, yep, just be careful, Red Robin. Because as you can see, they're wearing sunglasses at night, which means they're very cool. And then they shoot grappling hooks and then take off.
That's awesome.
Yeah. It's fun to have a Batman who's just like, these guys are losers.
Yeah.
Like, and I will say it out loud. So, he gets the ID mask to disguise himself as someone who's invited to the auction. And then when he gets in, they give him a betting number and a gas mask. And everyone in there is like, again, they're rich people in tuxes and dresses, but they all have the gas masks. And the Dealer's up on stage, and he's like, the room is filled with Scarecrow's fear toxin! Woo-hoo-hoo! And, like, because these are all sick rich freaks, they're like, oh, that's so hot. And they're also like, this place they're meeting up in is like a burnt-down orphanage, jeez, where, like, 46 kids, like, burn to death.
Oh,
and they're all like, oh, spot. I love it here, this is so good!
Jesus Christ.
It's like, this is some fucked up shit. So, of course, the first thing up on the auction is the crowbar that killed Jason Todd.
Oh, okay. Nice.
And they make sure to, like, in like include, like, yeah, it's from the Middle East, because that's where he died. And it's still got some brain chunks on it, so and everyone's like, oh, yes, I must have it.
I need to lick that
off. Yeah, I need to lick that off. The history. And the Dealer is like, oh, by the way, Batman, I know you're here.
What?
Yeah, we make sure to call everyone before the meetings, and your guy didn't pick up, so you're obviously him. We know. All right, we know. So that's why your mask has no filter.
Oh, nice.
So Dick Grayson's like, oh, everything looks scary. Oh, no, I'm freaking out.
Tripping balls.
Yeah, and all these rich people are like, get him. Take his limbs.
Holy shit.
Give me his eyes. They're all fucking freaks. And he's like, this is bad news bears. And he's Dick Grayson. He's raising the circus. So he's jumping over people's heads like he's fucking Mario. Gets up to the front, takes the crowbar, pushes the old guy over.
Funky.
Yeah. Ah, you'll never escape. Oh! He's pushed. And then he escapes through, like, the ceiling, or up into the, like, attic of the building. And then he jumps out the window, and he passes out. And when he wakes up, he's back at his penthouse. Barbara is there. And she's like, I'm sorry, Dick, but when we found you, they took your legs.
Oh, God.
And he's missing his legs. He's like, oh, no. And then she's like, but that's okay, because there's still some of you left for me. And then she pulls out a knife.
What?
And, uh-huh. And then Dick wakes up again.
Oh, geez.
Because the fear toxin is in him.
Oh, yeah, okay.
And it's going to be in him the whole book.
Oh, Oh, shit.
Because the theme of Black Mirror is that, like, being Batman will fuck with you.
Yep.
And it's like, the legitimate reason is that he has this fear of toxin messes with his head, but it's like, the narrative thing is like, the longer he's Batman, the darker things are going to get and the harder it's going to be for him as a person.
Jesus Christ.
Which is difficult because the thing about Dick Grayson is that he's the polar opposite of Bruce Wayne. He's a happy person. He's friendly. He's, like, friends with nearly everyone in the DC, like, superhero community. He actually wakes up. He's like, oh, my legs, thank God. And they're like, you know, he has the crowbar. Like, he managed to salvage that. Like, nobody knows how he got from outside the murder house or whatever to back home. But he is, and he's safe. And he's like, oh, no. Like, I left. That means, and, like, we immediately cut to, like, a plane taking off.
Mm-hmm.
And what's his name? The dealer is there, like, oh, time to leave the country. Batman's on to me. He got away. I gotta go. And he's got, like, boxes and crates of, like, his collection.
Jesus
Christ. In the back of the plane. And Batman puts on this, like, let me see if I can find it. He puts on this, like, kind of sick armor. It kind of reminds me of, like, the gray armor he wears in BVS.
Oh, damn.
Batman jumps out of a plane, like, his plane, jetpacks over to the dealer's plane, breaks in, beats up the dealer's dudes, and the dealer's like, okay, well, I'm just gonna
shoot down the plane.
No. He's gotta catch them.
He's fucking launch a missile at it.
Non-lethal. They're non-lethal missiles.
Non-lethal, but I'll break every bone in your body.
I'll make sure they fall right in the ocean, but the soft part.
Yeah.
And drown.
I don't think you know how the ocean works, Batman. Also, in my head canon, that's Dick Grayson doing an impersonation of Bruce Wayne.
Yeah.
That's not actually his voice.
Yeah.
So, he flies into the plane, beats up the dudes. The dealer's like, well, I'm just an old man. Until I take this drug.
Oh, God.
Yeesh. And so...
Everyone's got a plot twist.
Everyone's got a drug in their back pocket. He's like, are you familiar with Man-Bat? And he's like, oh, yeah, Man-Bat's really messed up. He's some dude that turned himself into, like, a human bat. That was Jesus. Really... Like, and it's like... Really out of the box, the
Batman
villain.
Yeah, really weird,
man. Yeah, why would
don't
you,
mind
bring,
what I'm doing
why would
right
you
now.
Bring that up? Yeah. He's like, yeah, and he becomes Man-Bat.
Yeah.
Jesus.
But he's like hairless, so it's grosser.
Oh, it's like
yeah.
A hairless cat.
Yeah, but wings. And Dick's just like, oh, gross.
Don't you want to touch him?
Yeah, well, it's funny because the dude's already old. We know that these chemical formulas are, like, worse enough that if you take too much, it'll kill you. So he gets a couple swings in, and then, like, they're both falling out of the sky, the Man-Bat guy just dies.
Just ODs.
They don't find his body later, but whatever.
Just decomposed.
Yeah, and it's funny because as they're falling, all of the super-villain memorabilia, it's like one of the Penguin's, like, umbrellas is falling. For some reason, Riddler's entire costume's flowing in the wind, and it's like, okay, that's a bit
just
more than intact. Yeah, just his entire onesie is just floating in the wind. So... Following that, Dick Grayson's like, ah, that's one problem wrapped up. Barbara, what's going on with you? Jim is going to this diner with Barbara, and they're talking because Jim Gordon was getting some phone calls from his son, James Gordon Jr. Now, the thing about James Gordon Jr. is that before this, the last story he shows up in is actually when he's, like, born. So it's kind of like, I think the idea is that Jim Gordon Jr. has got to be, like, 23 or 25, like,
okay.
Around that range. And the first time he shows up is when he's a newborn in a story called Batman Year One. You're familiar with that, Bennett. As a baby, he's almost dropped off a bridge by a criminal.
Jesus.
And Batman, like, Bruce Wayne Batman, during, like, the first year of his career, is the one to save Junior from falling. But, like, the fall, like, he didn't... It's like the altitude kind of has, like, trauma.
Yeah.
That's what would happen if you're a kid and you fall off a bridge and you live through it. And, like, we learn in this story that as Junior grew up, he had, like, psychopathic tendencies.
Damn.
Like, he never killed anyone as a kid, thank
yeah.
God, but he hurt people and he didn't show any remorse for hurting people.
Jesus.
And, like, he had that vacant, like, stare that, like...
1,000-yard stare.
Yeah, that, like, murder kids have. That, like, troubled youths get. So... Jim Junior returns to town. He's, like, trying to get in contact with his dad. And Barbara is like, Dad, don't talk to him. Like, he's bad news. I know he's your son. I know you want to make things better. he's crazy. And she thinks this because when she was a teenager, her friend went missing, and she thinks Junior is the one that, like, got rid of her.
Jesus.
Because this friend gave, like, him, like, a little bit of lip.
Ooh.
And that was enough to be like, oh, well.
Well, you're dead now.
You're dead now. Congratulations, you're dead now. Nice to meet you. I'm Jim Scorn Jr. it's my card, you're dead. But Barbara is like, do not talk to Junior. Okay, he's bad news. Anyway, bye. And she gets in a wheelchair and she goes. So she leaves, and Jim turns. He turns back, and Junior's there.
Of course.
Oh, yep.
I've been waiting for you, Father. Like, he's like, I know Barbara isn't ready to, like, talk to me, but I want to talk to you, Dad. And according to Junior, when he was, like, gone for a while, like, he left town, he went down to, like, Texas, I think, and he took part in, like, a medical trial, and the pills help him, like, mellow out and, like, actually care about things.
Be less crazy.
Yeah, exactly. He's like, the pills help me, and I'm trying to do what the doctors did for me for other people. So he's trying to get a job in Gotham working for, like, a pediatrician who makes medicine for babies.
Okay.
And he wants Jim to put in a good word for him. And Gordon's like, yeah, okay, hey, Junior, what's that splotch of red on your shirt? And Junior's like, oh, it's blood, Dad. It's blood from the woman I murdered, and I stuffed her head in the toilet. And now it's overflowing.
He says it's crazy.
And Gordon's like, James. And he's like, I'm just kidding, it's ketchup.
Okay.
Sorry, my humor isn't really on par with people right now. I probably shouldn't be making jokes like that.
Ketchup, there's a dad.
He's like, all right, put in a good word for me. Later, Dad. Later. Bye. And he walks out. And Jim, like, once Junior's out, Jim gets up from the booth, and he runs over to the men's bathroom, and it's overflowing. He's like,
Jesus
Christ. And he goes in, opens the stall. The toilet is just stuffed with toilet paper.
Oh, Jesus
And it's
Christ.
Like, what kind of elaborate bullshit is this? Like, I want him to think I murdered someone.
Yeah.
But then I'll say it's a joke. But then he'll check, and it'll still be a joke.
Yeah.
To secure the joke. But, as a result, I'll look even more crazy.
True, yeah.
So that's what's going on with Jim.
Jesus.
Meanwhile, Dick Grayson's dealing with his own traumatic history. This woman who owns a bank, she's got this big, luxurious penthouse. She comes out into her foyer or whatever. And listen, it must be a really big, like, penthouse that she lives in. Because in the foyer is a dead whale.
Okay.
Wow.
Random.
I don't...
Like, not a fossil of the whale?
Just
a
whole...
A full whale?
A whole ass whale.
Okay.
Whales are fucking big.
Like, whales are really big.
Yeah.
If it were any of us, I feel like we'd turn around, walk back into the bedroom, and be like, let's try this again. Nope, whale's still there.
Yeah. I didn't even fit a whale.
Right, it's like...
You need to take the roof off?
Yeah, I guess so. We don't see how they get the whale to the crime lab that the Wayne set up.
It just happens.
Yeah, it's just there now.
Love that.
And, like, you know, Dick Grayson's analyzing it, and he's like, wow, this is, like, the second time we've used this lab ever. This is great.
Like, wow, this is a whale.
Well, it's like, the fucked up part is that, like, he's like, this is the type of whale it is. This is the gender of the whale. Normally, this whale, with the gender that it is, shouldn't grow to be this big. So whoever captured it gave it some sort of hormone to make it get bigger.
Also, how's the whale not, like, decaying?
Right. I guess it's freshly dead. It's like in a mob movie when they deliver a fresh horse head in a box, but it's a whale.
Okay.
So Dick is looking at it, and, like, he's trying to cut it open, and then he gets sidetracked talking to Gordon. And then in the background, you just hear, like, sloop.
Yum.
And they turn, and fucking Sonya's assistant is, like, dead and nude, and she fell out of the whale.
Jesus.
Like, whoever... Someone fed the assistant to the whale and then took the whale to Sonya's place and then, I guess, made it bigger and then left.
And killed
Jesus
it?
Yeah. And it's like, we just had two very, like, very complicated crimes back to back.
Yeah.
Stuffing the toilet isn't a crime, but it might be, like, some sort of property damage. Anyway. So, like, Dick Grayson is like, all right, well, I gotta investigate this whale.
Yep.
This whale situation. And... What's funny is that when Dick Grayson is talking to Jim in the crime lab, Dick Grayson, or Jim is like, hey, you know, I wasn't really, like, going to tell you about this, but, like, how else are we supposed to look at the whale? Like, that's the only reason I'm bringing this to you. And Grayson's like, what are you talking about? He's like, well, so Sonia Branch owns, like, a business. She runs this bank. And she was born from a criminal, right? And she rose up from the ranks and got out of... it's like, her father was a criminal, and she could have just followed her family footsteps, but she worked really hard to get out of that life mm-hmm. and then start her own bank.
Okay.
The kicker is that her father was Tony Zucco, the man who killed Dick Grayson's parents.
Oh, shit.
But she's also, like, around his age and attractive, and she clearly, like, is putting the moves on Batman. And he's like, this is really messed up because... Your parents killed my mom, and you're so hot. And, like, you're so hot, yeah. And I don't know, yeah. It's like, this is really hard for me. So, he's like, all right, who would put a whale in your house? Just cut through
just,
it. Who?
Yeah, just tell yeah. Nobody, not anybody.
Yeah, of the people you know, like, which is the most likely to put a whale in your house?
Yeah.
She's like, if I had to think about it, and she names off these two, like, crime lords, who have been trying to get her to play ball. Because they're like, they think that because she's Tony Zucco's daughter, she's like, you know, like him.
She has, like, power.
Yeah, and they're like, give us some of your bank money, right? Give us some money. And they're like, she's like, no, I'm not part of this crime bullshit. And so Batman is like, all right, I'm going to go investigate. First he goes to meet this character called the Roadrunner, who's just a dude. And it's like...
I was going to say, meet me.
Yeah, meet me. Because Warner Brothers, they own them both. And it's like, it's weird, right? Because when we find out he's going after a Roadrunner, Batman goes to the most unlikely place to find this guy. And it's just a car dealership.
Oh, nice. Just a normal
yeah,
car dealership.
Because we've come up with every other Batman villain. We need a car one. We need a car villain. So the Roadrunner steals expensive cars and then sells them back on the black market. So Batman goes to this car dealership, this illegal one, dodges gunfire, and the criminals eventually get him to, like, go down this, like, chute. And it's, like, at first it looks like an underground garage.
Mm-hmm.
And then it turns out to be, like, I don't know, I guess the crusher, right? For, like, junk cars.
Oh, yeah.
Crushes them into cubes. And he's like, oh, no, I'm gonna get crushed. He's, like, he's trying to escape this, like, death trap. This, like, you know, the Star Wars pit thing.
Yep.
And he finds this old car, and he's like, of course the engine's gone. And so he goes and looks at another car. And he's like, man, any of the other Robins would have no problem with these cars. I don't know anything about cars. But he manages to, like, get one engine working with some, like, electric tech in his belt. And he basically drives the car full of explosives through the door so that he can escape.
Jesus.
And then Roadrunner, who had walked down there... Again, Roadrunner's just some dude.
Mm-hmm.
The only thing is that Roadrunner has those prosthetic legs that, like... you know how some Olympic runners have, like, those, like, little, like... They look like clips. Like, metal clips to, like, run.
Oh, yeah. Like
Olympic runners that don't have their legs. Yeah, they have those things. He has those.
Okay.
And, because he's a pompous-ass villain in Gotham, he had to walk down there to be like, ah, the destruction of Batman. And then Batman breaks in and he's like, oh, no!
Oh, shit, I don't have any legs.
Yeah, I don't have legs. Take sympathy on me, and Batman's like, "All right, Roadrunner, you're gonna talk. You're gonna squeak. You're gonna make some bird sounds for me."
Yeah.
And Roadrunner's like, "I'll use my special power of running," and so he uses his legs to run away really fast.
Jesus.
Not like the Flash, but like a fast guy.
Yeah, above average.
Above average. Yeah. Exactly. Roadrunner's like, "Goodbye," and he runs off. He starts jumping. Batman is just like grappling hook around the legs.
Nice.
Right? Roadrunner just fucking eats it. And I think Batman is like, I think he would have gotten away faster if maybe he like, painted some sort of tunnel on a wall and maybe run into it. So he's like, alright, tell me why you put a whale in this lady's house. And Roadrunner's like, what are you fucking stupid? Why would I put a whale in someone's house? That's not my deal. Now if it was a dead car, that's
true.
My deal. That's how you know. I like to imagine there's a version of the story where it is a car, and they open it, and the girl's, like, in the trunk or something. But, he's like, I didn't do anything. And it's like, okay, well, I'm still gonna bust you for crime. So he's like, I'll go to the second person. This guy called Tiger Shark. And Tiger Shark is just some dude in a suit with, like, a red mask over his face. Not a red hood, but a red mask. And, His deal is ocean stuff, so really he should have just gone to him first. Yeah. He's got shark in his name.
Come on, yeah.
And, like, in the process of trying to find him, he gets... Batman ends up on, like, this private yacht that Tiger Shark has. And Tiger Shark literally has him, in sort of a James Bond sort of way, has Batman hanging over a pit of sharks.
Nice.
He's like, how did I get myself in this situation? Good thing I brought my bat shark repellent. So, And Tiger Shark is, like, weird, because I think he can talk, but he chooses not to. He uses his henchmen to talk. Like, he'll whisper something into their ear.
Jesus.
And then the henchman will be like, Tiger Shark says that you made a big mistake coming here, Batman.
He's just, like, antisocial? Or...
I don't know. Maybe just shy.
He's too scared to talk
to Batman. No. I gotta keep up the massage that I'm mysterious. Or he just has a really bad voice. He doesn't have a voice for being a villain.
You made a mistake!
You made a real mistake coming here. So... So the first guy that is talking for Tiger Shark is like, you'll find that the sharks are, you know, very hungry, Batman. They come from this part of the world. Like, he's giving them, like, a history thing. And then Tiger Shark shoots that guy and pushes him into the pit of sharks.
Jesus.
And then he calls another dude over, whispers in his ear. He's like, that guy was not properly communicating what Tiger Shark wanted to say to you. That's why I'm here. He's like, Tiger Shark would like you to know that his suit is made out of a rare shark from, like, the Philippines.
Jesus Christ.
And his shoes are made from a rare crocodile, and his belt is made from a snake. And it's, like, Tiger Shark's whole
just
deal...
flexing on Batman.
Yeah, Tiger Shark's whole deal is, like, he hunts... Or, I guess, he somehow gets his hands on, like, endangered animals.
Yeah.
And turns them into fashion. And it's, like, just a flex. Like, oh, yeah, I could save this this species of gator. Or... suit.
Yep, and just kill the last one.
Yeah.
Make the rarest suit.
So, Batman's like, look, I just want to know why you put a whale in Sonya Branch's house. And they're like, and the guy's like, Tiger Shark did not do that. Batman's like, oh, come on. So, he escapes capture. There's a part where, like, Batman has to punch these sharks out of the way.
Nice.
He's just in the water. Fuck you, shark. Tiger Shark tries to get away in, like, an escape pod. I think he does get away, but, like, his whole operation is torn down by Batman. And eventually Batman has to go back to Sonya, and he's all tired, and, like, there was stuff that Tiger Shark said, I guess to other guys, that led Batman on this way of thinking. Because he gets back to Sonya, and he's like, hey, so, I figured it out. It wasn't Tiger Shark, and it wasn't Roadrunner. It was you.
Really?
You killed your assistant, and you put her in that whale... And you put that whale in your house.
Jesus.
And she's like, why would I do that? And she's like, and he's like, because, like your father, you are a criminal, you are dirty, you are involved with all these organizations, and you didn't want the competition. So, instead of you going out and taking down these criminals, you had me do it for you.
Damn.
And she's like, I don't know what you're talking about. I run a legitimate business. And he's like, okay, well, good night, Miss Zuko. And she's like, it's Miss Branch. He's like, I know what I said. And he leaves. Junior runs into Dick Grayson on the street.
Hmm.
And it's intentional, because Jim Gordon had asked Dick to go talk to Junior, because, again, they grew up together as well.
Oh, okay.
And they're talking, and they reminisce about... Because Junior's like, I actually ran into this kid from school we went to school with. You remember he used to be a bully? He used to really give us a hard time. He's a good guy now. He runs, like, a supermarket over. A really nice guy. And Dick Grayson's like, oh, yeah, I'm glad, you know, you're getting your act together, you know, I'm glad you're talking to people, I'll give you a good word for that job you want to get. Anyway, bye. And Junior goes into this, like, townhouse, goes in the basement, and that bully he was talking about, that they talked about from high school, he's all chained up in the basement. Some of his limbs are missing, and his jaw is off.
Jesus Christ.
So it's just like a tongue. Like,
nice.
And Junior's like... He's washing his saw, and he's like, I ran into Dick Grayson earlier. Yeah, he was asking about you. Real nice guy. I think I'll go see him next.
Damn.
It's just like, what the fuck? This is not the same thing as the toilet paper thing. This is straight up, no, he's killing folk.
Jesus.
So, we get this flashback as to, like, what was the inciting incident that convinced everyone about Junior? Because Jim Gordon is like, Jim Gordon Sr.
Yeah.
is following this guy. This guy's a criminal who they pinned the death of Barbara's friend on this guy because he was like a serial killer.
Okay.
Now he's straight edge, he does a regular job, whatever. But Jim's following him because he's like, he wants to make sure that, like, if anything goes on around Gotham, it's this guy and not his son. Mm. Like, he wants to clear his name again.
Damn.
The other thing is that, like, Jim, that Junior was caught, like, releasing a bunch of birds from an aviary, but there's no actual evidence of him doing that, just that he was there. Mm-hmm. So he's, like, the prime suspect of that.
Yeah.
When they went on their camping trip, back when he was with the tenant, they met up with Barbara's, like, high school friend, mm-hmm. the one that we know will end up going missing. And we see the scene of, like, Barbara's friend has, like, a science kit, and she has one key, and Barbara has the case. So they can't open it without each other. So anytime they meet up, they'll do science stuff with their science kit. Whatever, it's cute. And, you know, Junior has the box for, like, a minute.
Okay.
And he's opening it. Like, he picked the lock.
Yeah.
And the kid is like, the Barbara's friend is like, what's wrong with you? Don't open my box. That's not for you. Give me that.
Yeah.
And, of course, this is the moment where Junior's like, oh, you want to die.
Yep.
Okay, I understand now. So, Jesus. And, of course, like, she goes missing. And then the thing that makes Barbara think that her brother did it is because her brother has a keychain that belonged to her friend.
Oh, my God.
And it's, and, like, in the present day, Jim Gordon follows this killer. He tries to question him about, like, you know, what are you up to? I know you're up to something. And this dude's like, I didn't do anything. And, like, Jim is starting to realize that, like, this whole time they've pinned it on this other dude when it very well was probably his son.
Yep.
So Jim also gets a call from, like, his wife. Like, he's investigating a crime scene. One of their cops is like, hey, Jim, your wife's on the phone. And it's his ex-wife or whatever. And she's like, it's his ex-wife, and she's like, I've been getting, like, phone calls from our son, Junior. Did he reach out to you? Because he's been reaching out to me. I'm a little scared. And then, like, the call is, like, cut off.
Oh, shit.
And so Jim, you know, goes to this, like, place that where his ex lives. I guess she's still in Gotham, but, like, pulls the curtains, and she's naked in the tub, all tied up, and she has, like, the Joker smile.
Oh, shit.
Like someone hit her with the Joker toxin.
Yeah.
And around the same time is when Joker escapes from Arkham.
Ooh.
And it's like a one-issue story where Dick Grayson Batman tracks down Joker. He's just hiding in a basement somewhere. And Joker's like, go away. Batman's like, what the fuck? No, you don't get... Oh, sorry. Wait, no, what am I doing? No, listen. You attacked Jim Gordon's wife. And he's like, you know that's not true. I just escaped. I have no time to get there and poison her. Like, plus, I have nothing against the Gordon family. I'm done with them.
Mm.
I crippled one of them. The other one's probably a crazy guy. Even I know that. You know. And in fact, Joker is like, that kid's actually not half bad. And Grayson's like, what are you talking about, Joker? At the same time, Gordon's on the phone with Junior.
Yeah.
He's like, Junior, where are you? And why can't I find your sister anywhere?
Oh, shit.
And Junior's like, Dad, do you remember when you used to try to scare me straight by putting me in Arkham Asylum for, like, a couple days? It wasn't that bad. I was actually a couple cells away from the Joker. He's a pretty nice guy. So, like, Joker and Jim Gordon Jr. got along when Junior was a kid, which is just another big red flag. Also, they say that Jim Gordon Jr. didn't cry when he was a baby ever, which is also, like, a really bad sign.
Weird, yeah.
There's a bit where, like, as a kid, he's opening up a bird to see where the eggs come from.
Oh,
like, Jesus. It's just every time, there's, like, nothing redeemable about this kid.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, what is it? Joker is like, I didn't attack the Gordons, I just wanted to escape from Arkham, and I'm not gonna fight you, Batman, because the fact is, you're not my Batman. Like, I know that you're probably one of the Robins, I guess, but, like, I know you're not my Batman. So, yeah. So when he comes back, you let him know that I'm down here, and we'll take it from there. Batman's like, alright, sure. No, wait, what am I doing? No, you're under arrest, and he cuffs him. Joker's like, I'll just get out again.
Yeah.
You just put that fucker down.
Basically, it comes down to Junior being alone with Barbara. Like, they're in, like, an abandoned warehouse or something. And when Barbara wakes up, she has these, like, two knives in her legs.
Jesus.
And she can't feel it, obviously. Yeah. But if either of the knives is pulled out, she'll bleed to death.
Damn.
Junior is like, I knew you always hated me, and in a way, like, that made me appreciate you more. Because everyone else would act like I was normal, but you knew there was something up with me.
Yeah.
And, like, prior to this, like, another kind of like detail that's a part of this is that like the medicine that Jim Gordon Jr. was working on for babies, right? It was supposed to be an antipsychotic to like prevent children from having that trauma way too early and developing in a messed up way.
Becoming him.
Yeah. But apparently this guy learned fucking chemistry because when they research one of the pills, because what was it? Gordon snatches one of the pills off of his son. The formula was reversed. So instead of diluting a psychosis, it would double it.
Jesus.
And in fact, those are the pills that Junior's been taking the whole time.
Damn.
So instead of getting better, he's been making himself more and more like numb emotionally.
Yeah.
And he's on the phone. Now he's on the phone with Dick Grayson. Because that's the other thing. Like, Batman tries to call Oracle, Barbara Gordon. Junior picks up the phone like, yes, my sister's quite busy. She's got her legs full. And Batman's like, Junior, I'm coming to find you. Don't hurt Barbara. And freaking Junior's like, you don't need to put on a performance for me, Dick Grayson. I know it's you. So it's like, he knows he's Batman.
Jesus.
Yeah. This guy, just... They want to set up Junior as, like, Dick Grayson, Batman's Joker.
Yeah.
Right? That's why it's called Black Mirror, because it's his reflection or something. So, Junior's on the phone, he's like, you know, Dick Grayson, there's something about you I never liked. I hate you the most, because you wear your heart on your sleeve, and you're all about compassion. And in my experience, having emotions is a weakness, and you go and pretend like it's your superpower.
Yeah.
And, like, that's, like, enough... That's, like, Scott Snyder's epitaph between these two having a rivalry. Is like, James Gordon Jr. is like, emotions are bad, the cold, calculated killer, that's how the strong survive.
Yeah.
Dick Grayson is like, I'm just a nice guy. I just want to help people.
I just want to make
jokes. It's messed up that you don't think what you're doing is wrong. So, Jr. is, like, on the phone, and he's like, all right, I'll see you soon. And he hangs up. He's like, now, Barbara, and, like, the wheelchair's there, but she's gone. And he's like,
wait, oh, what? Bitch go?
She crawled away. What the fuck? Yeah. And he's like, fine, we'll play hide and seek. Picks up a knife. I'm gonna find you. And like, he almost gets her, and then she takes one of the knives out of her leg to like cut him in the eye.
Jesus.
Oh. And then he's still like, it's not over yet.
Just unfazed by it.
I guess hide and seek is over. I guess now it's time for tag. Now I'm it. Like, is your whole thing going to be child games? Like, is she going to get to the end of the hallway and there'll be like a hopscotch-themed death trap or something? You'll never escape the jungle gym of doom, Barbara. I had plenty of time to set this up. The whole weekend. So, he's like, now we're playing tag, and I'm it, and I'm going to get you. And then from the shadows, Batman's just like, can I play too? And then fucking grabs him. And in the scuffle... Junior gets away, but they're able to save Barbara. And, like, after this whole kerfuffle, Dick Grayson pulls, like, you know, because the Wayne Corporation is involved with, like, the pediatric child stuff, the medicine for the kids, and he's able to get it so that stuff is pulled, so that, like, and it's like, but there's a chance that some of that medicine got out and, like, had affected some of the children of Gotham.
Oh, shit.
And at the end of the book, Dick Grayson and Jim are basically tearing down the science lab that they've only used 3 times. Because it's just a waste of money.
Yeah.
And like, Jim is like, listen, this is really like tough for me. I know Junior's still out there. I'm going to keep looking for him. And he's like, when Junior was a kid, I almost let his like problem like destroy my relationship with my daughter. And part of it is what destroyed my relationship with my wife. And now he's out there, and I almost let it ruin my whole life again.
Yeah.
And Grayson is like, well, listen, you can't feel too bad about it, because, like, that's what he wants you to do. Like your son wants you to see that he's able to get one over on you because he doesn't have these emotions and he doesn't care about his family.
Yeah.
You should care about your family. Like, that was never the problem. Mm-hmm. And, like, you know that more now because of what you almost lost. So, at the end of this, you know, James Gordon Jr. is a Batman villain. Dick Grayson is realizing that, like, being Batman is not good for him.
Yeah.
And, like, you see that throughout the book. when he has the penthouse, the reason he doesn't want to live in the manor is because, like, he is a circus kid. He's not used to living and staying in one place for too long.
Oh, okay.
Like, that doesn't fit his lifestyle.
Mm-hmm.
When Alfred is like, so we found you in the alleyway, we found this garish crowbar. We don't even know if it's, like, the one that killed Jason or if it's a fake.
Yeah.
What should I do with it? And Dick is like, throw it in the river. Like, just get rid of it. Like, he's rejecting, basically, because, like, what is Batman's thing? He keeps trophies.
Yep.
He's like, oh, I'll put this giant dinosaur in my cave, this big penny, and this knife that almost killed me.
This fucking whale.
Yeah, this whale. But, like, Dick Grayson isn't Bruce. He doesn't keep trophies. He doesn't live in a cave. Like,
yep.
I think the idea is supposed to be that idea of, like, a father and his son somehow have a priority over a father and the daughter,
mm-hmm.
you know? And it's also, like, Junior was younger than Barbara as well, so it's like, Gordon is the kind of guy who's like, well, my son can't be sick because he's my son. He's good, and I raised him good, and it's like, and if it turns out he has a psychosis and he's a deranged person, then that
he
has
won't
to
do
mean
anything wrong.
That has to mean I messed up, which can't be true. So, it's you know, part of the story is Jim coming to terms with, like, I can't fix him, and fixing him was never the thing I should have done. I should have, like, been by his side instead of, I don't know, putting him in an asylum
maybe,
next to, like,
yeah.
a clown and a crocodile man. Like, maybe that was the wrong move.
Maybe, yeah.
Yeah, upon further reflection, maybe that was the wrong move. So, that is Batman Black Mirror. Again, shortly after this, the universe will essentially reset, but they'll still kind of talk about this sometimes. You know, Dick Grayson will go back to being Nightwing, Bruce Wayne will come back to being Batman. The next time Junior shows up, he has a cool eye patch because his sister stabbed him in the eye. And he'll also be like, I'm going to help out the Suicide Squad.
Oh, of course.
And everyone's like, all right, sure. And he's like, I'm also in love with Amanda Waller. And everyone's like, that's a little weirder, but all right. No one knows what to do with you now, Junior. Go on. Be yourself.
Jesus.
Yeah. So, Bennett, what did you think of Black Mirror?
I just fucking jumped around a lot.
Yeah.
It's tough to keep track in some areas.
Well,
it's too many. My thing is, like, with a lot of comic books, I feel like there's too many characters.
Yeah, there's too much going on.
There's too much bullshit.
I mean, a lot of them just kind of come and go. Remember that guy? The Tiger Shark?
Yeah,
guy?
Yeah.
Whisper.
Or the Roadrunner, you know?
Yeah. I'll run.
I mean, I think it was.
I kind of like
interesting story.
Yeah, I really like Roadrunner and Tiger Shark just as the idea of, like, filling out the crime world of Gotham.
Yeah,
because, like, some of them are obvious. Like, Penguin probably trades guns, and I don't know, Two-Face probably does money laundering. Who does the Seacoast crime?
Yeah,
who does the car crime in
yeah.
Gotham? Did you have a favorite, like, of those three portions? Right, the crime boss one, the dealer at the beginning, and then Junior. Which one did you like the most?
I feel like Junior, honestly. He just seems like that fucked up of a kid.
Yeah.
Right. Like, that was a kid, like, you grew up with, and you, like, questioned everything you'd say.
Yeah, it's
you know?
Like that weird
you, like, you'd be on the playground with him, you're like...
Christian, what did you think of Black Mirror?
I have two big questions.
Yeah.
One was, like, the Scarecrow.
The fear toxin?
Yeah. Did
or,
that ever affect him, like, after this at all? Or?
Yeah, little bits and pieces. Like, it mostly just kind of made him a bit unhinged.
Okay.
Like, that bit where he... The bit where he and Red Robin are stopping those dudes in the sunglasses on, like, the boat.
Mm-hmm.
Like, he goes there and he fights them. He gets knocked into, like, the bottom part of the boat. And, like, he thinks he sees, like, people in the shadows ready to grab
sure.
him.
That's
and he's
crazy.
Like... and, like, Robin... Or Tim, Red Robin, has to, like, pull him out of there.
Yeah.
So it does affect him over the course of the book. It wears off.
Like, how long after this does, like, Bruce Wayne come back into the picture?
Like, almost, like, immediately.
Really?
Yeah, it's kind of, it's weird, right? Because, like, he's doing this. I remember it specifically because there's a Superman book around this time called Superman Grounded. I think I have both the volumes up there. But the whole story is Superman walking across America.
Mm-hmm.
And at the beginning of the book, there's a portion where he meets up with Batman and it's Dick Grayson. They have this big conversation. Superman and Dick Grayson have a really good relationship. The
yeah.
name Nightwing comes from a Kryptonian legend.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah. And then in the back half of Superman Grounded, within 12 issues, I think there's, like, a span of time of, like, that book took, like, 6 months, but at the back half of Grounded, Batman shows up again, and it's Bruce. He's like, hey, what's going on? Heard you were talking to my kid again. Yeah.
Okay.
Of the three main stories, did you have a favorite?
Just the orca really threw me off.
The big whale.
And then just how he put it all together, that it was that lady.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was really cool. Again, it sets up another, like, crime boss character for Dick Grayson. It's a personal one. But yeah, the orca thing, I love that because it's like, you get this whole issue of just Jim Gordon in a diner with his son.
Mm-hmm.
And it's, like, really, it's very tense, and there's a lot of, like, parallels to murder and psychosis, and it's, like, it's really well, it's, like, red,
yeah.
the whole thing, because of, like, ambient light. And the next issue is, like, there's a dead whale in my house.
Yep. It's like, what?
Okay, Batman. So, yeah, Batman Black Mirror, I think in, like, collected editions, it's just called Batman Black Mirror, but everywhere else, it's, like, a couple issues of Detective Comics. It's weird.
Okay.
But, yeah, if you're interested, go check it out. Next time around, let me talk about next time around. I think something X-Men related, so that'll be fun. But, yeah, thank you all for joining us for this, guys. Thank you for being part of it.
It's good to be back.
And, as always, we will talk to you guys next time. Goodbye.
See ya.